Let's go over to France and we welcome Daryl Bradford Smith. Hi, Daryl.
Hello, Zaid. How are you, my friend?
Very well, thanks. How are you doing, Daryl?
Well, trying to recover from a little surgery, but I'm doing okay.
Oh, that's good. Brilliant. Daryl, will that 9/11 investigation ever reopen?
Well, the public has already reopened it, and we've never stopped investigating it because the original explanation was absolute nonsense. If you take a look at the facts, physics proves that the building was brought down by explosion. And we've got a professor from Brigham Young University in Utah who tested some of the metal that was present on the site after the destruction, and it included thermite. The thermite is a very powerful explosive, and you will find the residue of thermite throughout the site. And if you take a look at this whole incident, you know clearly that building 7 was imploded through demolition as
yes,
well.
Yes, yes. Now, Daryl, there was a few questions I want to ask you that were worrying you. One is, as Commander-in-Chief on the morning of 9/11, why didn't George W. Bush return immediately to Washington, D.C., or the National Military Command Center once he became aware that America was under attack?
Well, that is a very good question, and there's one that precedes that, Zaid, and here it is. When he was informed that there was an attack going on, his Secret Service did not take him out of that room. Now, why is that important? He had already announced that he would be there a week earlier, so everyone knew he was going to be at that school. If there was indeed a terrorist attack, how would he have known he was not in danger, since that building was already announced? The fact is, he knew in advance, and he knew clearly he was not in danger, and that's why he spent another 15 minutes sitting in that classroom, reading a book upside down. Now, you guys have to understand, there's an actual photograph, not doctored, where the President of the United States is actually reading a book upside down after this event. This man knew in advance, and he actually claimed he saw the first airplane hit the buildings. Now, the first airplane never was shown on TV. That was not shown until days later. Mm-hmm. How would he have seen the crash of that first plane unless he was part of the conspiracy?
Okay, then we go one further. On July the 5th, Richard Clark, I think it was, summoned all the domestic security agencies, that is the Federal Aviation Administration, the Coast Guard, Customs, the Immigration and Naturalization Service, and the FBI, and told them to increase the security in light of an impending attack. Were plans made to implement immediate countermeasures to deflect an attack, Daryl?
Well, here's another. That's a false flag situation with this guy, Clark. Clark is a spokesman for the criminals. And I'll tell you why it is. Basically, if it's a fallback plan for the administration, they would like to be seen as incompetent if they are caught with this,
yes,
rather than culpable. They would like to be seen as the people who could have done something but did not. And you will notice from Mr. Clark's assertions that he is still blaming Islam and Muslims for the impending attack, not an internal attack.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was really placed out in the public realm as a diversion so that people would think at the very most, George Bush and company were just incompetent in their job, but not complicit.
Yeah, yeah. And if there is to be a question going to George Tenet, then definitely Daryl, I'd be asking him, why didn't the CIA share vital information about the terrorists with the FBI beforehand?
Again, George Tenet is a bought and paid for gentleman, and you will find that the FBI is deeply involved in this conspiracy. In fact, more than any other agency within the government. And you'll also know that the organization of the FBI is controlled by the Justice Department. Who is in control of the Justice Department? Well, it used to be the Attorney General Ashcroft, who all of your listeners will maybe remember was guilty of one crime after another when it came to civil liberties and everything else. The new criminal in charge of that organization is a man named Benjamin Chertoff, who happens to be a dual Israeli citizen, and he is one evil character. and he is in charge of the FBI. You will find that also Tenet's role in this is a false flag. There was no conspiracy in Islam to attack America, period. Mm-hmm. End of story. It is a fabrication from start to finish. And your listeners who are of the Muslim faith need to understand clearly that their religion played absolutely no part in any of that attack.
Mm-hmm. Why wasn't Bin Laden brought to the United States for trial when there was a time when Sudan offered to extradite him, Daryl?
Well, he's an operative. His name is Tim Osman in the CIA parlance. He was an operative of the U.S. government and has been an asset of the CIA and the U.S. government for over 20 years. And he was actually just used as a bad guy. They needed somebody to point to as the criminal mastermind behind the events that they were going to carry out themselves. This comes right out of the Israeli playbook. You will find another man named Abu Nidal was the exact same kind of bad guy. Mm-hmm. This man, Abu Nidal, was an Israeli fabrication, and they used him to run around the Middle East inflicting a terrible terrorism on innocent people, they said. But in fact, it was the Mossad and the Israelis doing it. The same MO, the same modus operandi is being used with Bin Laden. Bin Laden's family and the Bush family are very close, and Bin Laden has been an asset of the United States government since the early 1980s.
Mm-hmm. And all these videos that we're seeing Bin Laden coming through to make statements, recent talk coming out from France itself about his death, and Clinton making a statement he should have killed Bin Laden, he had an opportunity to do that. How does the ordinary man read into all of this?
Well, see, that's one of the things. If you're getting your news from the mainstream, Saeed, you're being manipulated, and that has always been the case. Bill Clinton is as guilty in all of this as George W. Bush. Clinton is just a stand-in for the criminals behind them. So is George Bush. Neither of those men made the decisions about how to do these things to the planet. They were made at much higher level. Henry Kissinger and above him. Henry Kissinger is very, very involved in the day-to-day planning of these criminal actions against humanity.
Mm-hmm. Coming back to the hijackers of 9/11 itself, Daryl, do we know which hijackers have been positively identified by DNA? And is the FBI in possession of DNA samples for all the hijackers?
There is no evidence there were any hijackers in the first place. Mm-hmm. None. They did not show up on passenger lists in Boston's Logan Airport. They did not show up on passenger lists in Newark. In fact, those names were added to the investigation after the fact. Mm-hmm. And in fact, 7 out of the 19 supposed terrorists are actually still alive and well in Muslim countries. One of them is an airline pilot in Morocco. Yes. Now, we know as a fact that these people, some of them were operatives. Now, there is evidence that goes back to a man named Jack Abramoff, who is an Israeli operative within the Mossad and the ADL, the Anti-Defamation League of B'nai B'rith, who were instrumental in pulling off the 9/11 attack. These so-called terrorists were aided in their living conditions, in their payment for rent, by this man Abramoff. He even gave them free cruises on gambling boats. He owns gambling ships, and he gave Mohammed Atta free access to his gambling boats in Florida. Mm-hmm. So we see the connection directly to the highest levels of the criminal network of Israel